This is Clive Allen bringing you highlights of the long distance final, the third of the five medal races in the World Orienteering Championships. This is the classic forest event, a true test of physical strength and endurance, as well as route choice and route finding skills. For many top orienteers, winning this race is the pinnacle of orienteering achievement. There has been a race like this in the World Championships ever since the first ever championships held in Finland in 1967. We are deep in the forest now after our two town races, and we've got an attentive big crowd, many of whom have been orienteering in the forest on their own courses in a different forest this morning. And they've now come down here in the rain, I'm afraid, at least at this stage, to cheer on their favourites. Plenty of Swiss, as we saw also in Trento 2 days ago, have come to support their team today. And most other nations who are taking part in this final will have some supporters too. Every one of the 54 nations represented here in Lavarone in northern Italy can enter one athlete in the women's race and one in the men's. A national quota system allows for up to three athletes for the stronger nations, and the world champion from last year gets a personal place too. Here's the women's course, and you can see on the right it's got a length of 11 kilometres, a climb of 495 metres and 23 controls. And the estimated winning time is 77 minutes, which is remarkably fast when you think of the distance there. That 11 kilometres is as the crow flies. The forest is steep and thick with undergrowth and old branches and all sorts. This part is nice and open and runnable. It's not all like this. And all the top orienteers have trained hard in this kind of terrain so that they've learnt the physical skills of crossing the ground really fast, as well as reading their map on the run to see exactly where they're going to go next. You can see that it requires strength as well as stamina for this length of course that they're going to do, and also a great deal of agility. Here is the kind of control they're coming to. Red and white marker there, and the runner carries an electronic tag which he puts onto the top of the marker, and that records that he's been there. And at the end they check all of the tags to make sure that the competitor has been to all of the controls. Here is the course for today's race, and the map looks very, very complicated. It is pretty complicated, but we can simplify it a bit. The competitor has to visit all of the controls, which are marked with the circles, but they can take any route they like between the controls. And in this event, route choice is key to success. You can see some of these legs are pretty long, others are very short. So the techniques they have to use in choosing their routes and then following them are quite different. 16 to 17 there, they've got a passage through the arena, through the finish arena. And so they can be distracted quite a lot there before they have this short loop to the double circle, which is the finish. As I said, this map is very complicated, but the black is all roads and tracks, and that's the first thing to look for. And as we go along, I'll explain a little bit more. Now we're looking a little bit more closely, and here is an example of some of the route choice. We've got three different ones possible here from 4 to 5 that the planner has looked at. You can see that they're of varying lengths, but maybe the longer one is the quicker because there's far more on the roads and the tracks, the black I already mentioned, if you look at the green line to the left compared to the blue line to the right. So it's still a very feasible choice. Here we are at the start, and one of our early competitors is Svetlana Mironova from Russia, just heading out from the start and into the forest. And Svetlana was a name we don't know a great deal about, but she did get the silver medal in the European Championships earlier this year. Now one of the real favourites for today, Tove Alexandersson of Sweden. She has been right at the top, both in foot orienteering and ski orienteering in the winter in this sport. And then we have also in the field today the already double world champion this year, Judith Wieder from Switzerland. She won the sprint in Venice on Saturday and is in the winning team in the sprint relay in Trento 2 days ago. There's Judith going off. She's had a good rest now. She's going to do her utmost to be winning today. Here's another runner who we see as one of the favourites, Ida Bobak from Denmark. Ida is quite young still. She's only been in the senior ranks a couple of years, but already has a silver medal at World Championships level to her credit. And she looked very focused there and already concentrating on her map for the run. And one of the very last starters today, the Norwegian Mari Fasting. Mari Fasting, again, fairly young, coming up into the senior ranks and already making her mark there. We're back into the arena and the crowd watching what's going on. And here we've got one of the very early finishers, one of the very early starters, Goril Running Sund from Norway, coming into the finish. And she's taken 1 hour and 22 minutes for her 11 kilometres. Of course, she's actually run a great deal more than that in finding her route. Here we've got our Russian that we mentioned a little ago, Svetlana Mironova, out in the middle of the forest, focusing strongly on her map, choosing her route for the next leg, and then following it. And here she is again, somewhat later, of course, coming into the finish. And a good finish here, and a good time, 1 hour 19 and 44 is a time which is only a little bit over the estimated winning time of 1:17, which the planner had. So this is a time that we're going to be looking for all of the others to beat as the race progresses. Here we've got control 13, 6.6 kilometres into the course, with Judith Wieder punching there, coming straight to it, and you can see that Mironova had the lead at that particular kind. And we can also watch some tracking here. They all carry GPS trackers in the race, and Mironova at this point up to control 15 is still the leader over Alexanderson and Wieder coming to that point. Here's Tove Alexanderson out in the forest. A nice, long, loping style she has. You can see she reads her map on the run. She effortlessly goes over some of these branches. And down the hill and straight into the control here, control 20 on her course. This is 9.6 kilometres of the 11K course for her. And you can see at this point she's 1:17 down on Mironova. Not impossible to catch, but you'd probably like to be a little bit closer than that. Here's Judith Wieder also coming to the same point. Again, spot on to the control. Has a quick check of the description for the next control, which is on her wrist there. Looks at the map, quick decision which way to go. But in fact, she'd already looked at it, I'm sure, before she got to that control. These runners think ahead and plan ahead. Here's a bit more tracking, showing Mironova coming towards control 20, which we just saw. Round the crag there into the control and quite nicely ahead of the others. And here she is, chatting in the armchair for the leading runner with the Norwegian runner, Goril Running Sund, who is still second here. Now in the pouring rain, here comes Alexanderson into the finish, and a good finish for her, but it's not going to be gold for her today, I'm afraid. She's already 25 seconds over Mironova's time. As she heads for the finish line, she's made up quite a lot of time, but just not quite enough on Mironova. This is second place at this point, of course, 31 seconds down for Tove Alexanderson. So a very, very tired Tove Alexanderson at that point. And here's Judith Wieder coming into the finish, the already double world champion, but it won't be today because she's 38, 39 seconds over Mironova's time. And although she's finishing very strongly, she doesn't look too tired, she's not taking too much out of herself. She's lost some time on the way, route choice or whatever it was, and finishes in third place there, 50 seconds down on Mironova's time. So at this point, that's the order. Mironova, Alexanderson, and then Wieder. And we know now that she was the winner, and she was showing it there. Great pleasure for the Russian girl. And there's Mari Fasting coming in to fourth place, 2:22 down on Mironova's time, and very, very tired as well. So here's a little bit of tracking showing how the four leading competitors went through the course, and if you follow them through the various lines, you can see that in this part of the course they all followed a similar time, but Wida made an error at number three. She went a little bit south, and maybe that was a decisive moment for her. But here on the long leg, you can see we saw the alternatives earlier on, the alternative possibilities, and Fasting took a route much to the right. Wida here is taking a route far to the left, using the paths and the tracks. Alexanderson and Mironova, Alexanderson particularly strong, going much more direct. And Alexanderson was right up with Mironova in time at this point, as you can see the comparative tracking, and almost ahead of her there. But the race was so tight here, and Alexanderson got ahead through from 7 to 8 and was leading at this stage of the race. She goes direct a great deal of the way because she's so strong, she can run up and down the hills, and all the brown lines, these are contours on the map. But here she made an error. She came round south at number 9, Alexanderson, and she lost crucial time there. Now you can see Mironova is well ahead, and it was just approaching number 9, which was the decisive point. But look here, Mironova here goes all the way round the edge of the map here on this road. Alexanderson and Wida, they go more directly, direct across to the terrain. A much shorter route, but it's taking them so much longer. This was the leg where Mironova won the race. This was the one that really mattered. And very, very few competitors we know now went all the way around there, but that was the right thing to do. And here you can see she's holding her lead. Alexanderson so strong, comes up, but she never caught her. So here's the final results for the women's race today. The new world champion at long distance was Svetlana Mironova there, and she was the silver medalist at the European Championships, so great stuff for her there. And both Emily Kemp and Alison Crocker, they finished next to each other in the results in the high 20s, and they'll be pretty pleased with that today. Now we move to the men's course. The men's is of course longer, and they have 33 controls altogether here, and you can see the course being built up here. The green on the map, there's not too much of it actually here, but it is thicker forest. The white is all forest. The yellow is all open ground like fields and rough open country. The green means the forest is thick, slow to run through, best avoided if at all possible. We had a TV control at number 14. You'll see that a little bit later on. The course then comes through to number 19-20 here, and here's a speciality for the men's course, what we call a butterfly, which helps to avoid people following. We'll come back to that also a little bit later. They have an arena passage just like the women had, then this loop to control 30, which is another point where we'll be showing TV pictures of the race, and then into the finish with a total distance of 16.4 kilometers. A tremendous distance, and the height climb also is very, very considerable here. It's amazing how strong and skillful these male athletes are to be able to do this in the estimated winning time of 97 minutes. Here's one of the real experts, Thierry Georgiou from France. He was first in 2011 and 2013, and before that he's had middle distance wins at world championship level, several of them. He is one of the absolute experts in this sport. And here's another one, the Norwegian Olaf Lundenes. You can see again three first places in the long distance championships. Those two are going to go really go for it today. Here we are with Philip Dahlgren from Sweden. He's not got so many results behind him, but he's up and coming and one of the favourites for today's race, along with Lundenes and Georgiou. And also here, Daniel Hubman. We've seen Daniel in the sprint, of course. And he also was in the winning team in the sprint relay. Daniel Hubman, the best of the Swiss runners overall, we think. So now out in the course, we've got control 14 as one of our TV controls, and we're looking for Fredrik Johansson of Sweden, and he's approaching this control and is at this moment 44 seconds from being the quickest at it. We're looking for him coming up the hill here. Here he is coming through the forest and up the slope here. You can hear the rain in the background as he comes up to the control here, direct line into it, and then he stops. And here he's not sure, he's not planned the next bit of the course. Which way is he going to go next? He's losing quite a lot of seconds here in making his decision. Now he's decided, oh, wait a minute, he's still uncertain. And this is a little unusual because usually they've, before now, decided, before they get to the control, decided what to do. Here are two competitors taking very, very different routes here, approaching control four. And Jani Lakkonen from Finland has lost out by taking that route right round to the right. It was far too far, and he lost 3 minutes on that leg. Here's Baptiste Rollier from Switzerland coming to control 14, the first TV control after 7.3 kilometres, and going through there very nicely. And here's Thierry Georgiou. Now watch his technique here. He punches very quickly and he knows exactly where he's going next. You can see someone else is right behind him, but Georgiou has a lovely style through the forest. You can see him here. He really slides through the forest and has a marvellous running style. And he is so focused. He knows exactly where he's going. And you can see here, compared to the runner we saw earlier, he's not wasted very much time in deciding where to go next. He's looking carefully because it's a long leg he's starting on. He's got a long bit of planning to do, but he knew how he was going to start it as he went out. Now the sun's shining. That big shower went away and the Swiss are looking happy. Well, we'll see if they remain happy at the end of the race. Here we've got one of the Swiss, Fabian Hürtner. And he is also well up with the time here, coming up to control 14, only 9 seconds over Georgiou's time as he comes up towards the control. So he's had a very good first half of the race, or first third of the race, I should say, here. And he's going well, but again, hesitating. He hasn't planned the next bit. He's used all his mental effort in helping him get up that hill to the control. It's hard work there. And Olaf Lundenes there goes through, and he's taking the third place at that point. Here's a bit of tracking to show Daniel Hubman coming through towards control 14. And he's not far behind Georgiou and has taken a very, very similar route coming here. And here he is coming up the hill now to control 14 to punch. Daniel Hubman, a very, very experienced orienteer, but he's also stopped to plan this long leg carefully. Not for so long as some of the others, but anyway, he did do so. Now we've got coming into the arena passage here, Frederik Johansson. Frederik Johansson is in the lead at this point at the arena passage, and you can see here there is a drink point and a coaching zone. The coaches of the teams can give advice and help to the runners as they go through that particular point at the arena. Here you can see Hürtner, though, making a mistake. He went round in a big circle. He thought he was going towards the one control, and it should have been the other one, and he got it wrong. And Frederik Johansson comes into the finish here as the new leader. So a good run from the Swedish runner here, Frederik Johansson. Now we're back with Thierry Georgiou. Thierry Georgiou coming towards the second of our two radio controls and TV controls, rather, in the forest. And he's got somebody with him, and he's going, as you can see, really well here. And at this point, a lead of 4 minutes, 51 seconds, that's going some, over Johansson already in the finish. But he's got others behind him, as he knows, pretty close to him. I'm sure he will be concerned not to waste a moment. And here is Georgiou coming into the finish and finishing here to great acclaim from the French spectators and a new leader by 5 minutes 31 seconds over Johansson. What a lead, but will it hold? We'll see. Here we've got Baptiste Rollier finishing, and he is 6.34 down on Georgiou, and third to Johansson. A good run from him in many respects, but I think he'll be a little disappointed that he fell away a bit at the end. Okay. What happens afterwards? Well, they sit in a chair and talk to each other, like all orienteers do, discussing the route. And they're just comparing their different routes on one of the legs here. And all orienteers spend their social time after the race talking about routes. Where did you lose time? Where did you do it best? Here's Hürtner finishing. Fabian Hürtner's had a good run here, and he's finished here in current second place, 3.54 down on Georgiou's time. And we'll see if that's good enough for a medal at the end of the day. Here we can see now two of the later runners, Olaf Lundenes and Daniel Hubman, coming through to control 28, and Hubman has the faster time at this point. And here we've got Lundenes coming into the finish with a time of 2.24. at the end, and he is tired. He is tired. We heard beforehand that he'd had some back problems, so he's done really well to be as close to Giorgio as that. And here's Hubman, you can see, approaching Control 30, nicely ahead of London this time. And the question now is, can he do his bit here, something he's very good at in catching people up in the latest part of the race? He's got Matthias Kubitz, one of the fastest runners out on the course, just ahead of him there, a fellow Swiss, so pulling him along. Can they go together well enough to catch up Giorgio here, who's talking to the press? And here we've got the two of them coming into the finish. Kubitz just in front of Hubman, and Hubman's coming into a second place, 1:27 down on Giorgio. It is Thierry Giorgio who is the new world champion, or the world champion who is going to keep maintain his world championship, because he is also the current world champion. So Thierry Giorgio has shown himself to be the master of the forest again, and a brilliant finish for Giorgio. There was Kubert and Hubman coming through to the finish. They just didn't quite make it at the end of the day. So there we are, Thierry Giorgio, the world champion again at long distance. Daniel Hubman taking second place, the silver medal. Olaf Lundenes for Norway, the third. Here we can see the tracking for some of the race here, and Giorgio and Hubman took the right-hand route here on the long leg 3-4. Lundenes took the left-hand one, using more tracks and paths for some of the way. And then they came together there through control 8 on their way towards number 4. They pick up a path there, as you can see. They're following the path through. They've got a nice attack point, as we call it, through to number 4 there. And then quick short leg to number 5. And then a wandering route a little bit to number 6, with all three of them pretty close in time here. Giorgio didn't have too much of a lead here, and in fact was slightly slow into number 6, and London has caught him up, and you can see they've both got just the same time on this comparative tracking here. Now we've got London as ahead at this point. London has came through to number 8, just behind Giorgio. No, that was just the other way around, sorry. And now we've got Giorgio coming through ahead, through to number 9, with Londoners and Hubman behind. And here again, we've got our press from Londoners. He's pushing Giorgio hard in terms of the time, but Giorgio very, very strong, keeping ahead on this leg through to number 12. Taking slightly different routes here, as you can see. Londoners taking a line a bit more to the north. Giorgio picking up a bit of path there, and then coming into the control just ahead again of Londoners. All three of them actually pretty close together at this point again, as they head out on the long leg up now to 15. They all three chose this route, picking up this path here, passing that little field, and then coming through some pretty hilly terrain, but on a pretty direct line through to number 15, with Giorgio still ahead again. And then through 16, that short leg. And now we've got through to this butterfly, as we called it, where the following is avoided a little bit by them having to go through these little loops in different orders. You can see there that we've got them all, in fact, coming through in the same order in this particular case. They ordered the 19 to 20, and then 21, 22, 23, 24, like this. But Londoners actually had not gone to number 19 the first time round. He had to go through that as his second loop. Here we come down on more tracking, where they're pretty well together, Giorgio taking the route through the field there, and so on. Here is the final result. They all took pretty similar routes from there on. Thierry Giorgio the winner, Daniel Hubman in second place, Olav London was in third, Hertner got fourth, Kubitz got fifth place, Fredrik Johansson saw leading earlier, was the sixth place runner. And there we are, that is the end of the long distance race for today, and we bring you the middle distance race in a couple of days' time. Il secondo premio sarà Stefano Rovelli a consegnarlo a Daniel Hubman.